Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the North welcome to the North Dallas Plano Crew Focus Group meeting. It's January 26, 2024. Give me a thumbs up if you can hear me. Great. All right. Very, very good. All right. Let's see here. Make sure I get everything up and running here correctly. Our agenda this morning, we'll start out with success stories. Oh, let me clear this off the screen. I'll start with success stories. We'll then have everybody put their 30-second introductions in the chat window. We'll then hear from the practice interview team, the interview success workshop, the career tip of the week. And then our main event will be right around the top of the hour, all about ChatGPT and your job search. For those people on Zoom, if you have any questions throughout the presentation, please just put them in the chat window. For those on Facebook, thank you for joining us. Please just enter any questions you've got into the comment field. We'll be sure to get those questions answered for you. Please note this event is being recorded and is currently live on Facebook. The recording will be on the Career DFW Facebook page and the Career USA YouTube channel for others to view in the future. By participating in this event, you give consent for your name and picture to appear. Please note that any comments you put in the Zoom chat window will not appear in the recording. Well, good morning, everybody. Since 2007, I've been facilitating and leading the North Dallas Plano Career Focus Group. This group's been around since the late 1990s. I took it over in 2007 when the prior leader of this group landed a job. In 2008, I saw a need and created a website called careerdfw.org, a website to help those who are unemployed in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And then in 2012, I launched a second website, careerusa.org, to help those around the United States. I have written a book called What I've Learned About Your Job Search You May Not Know. It is available on Amazon. If you see me in person, I always have copies with me. And since 2017, I've been a member of the Practice Interview Team, also known as the PIT Crew. And you'll hear more about that in just a moment. Well, we'd like to start the meeting off with good news. Do we have any landings, any good news that people want to share here, there, anyplace? So anybody going once, going twice? All right, we'll keep on moving then. All right, what we'd love for everybody to do now is please, in the chat, open up your chat window for those online, and please put in your information. Give us your name, comma, phone number, comma, email address, position you're looking for. List two or three target companies, and then hit the return key. And what I will do is I will copy all this information, and I will put it out into an email this afternoon. I will update our roster, and I'll make sure I list everybody. If you list any target companies, I will list the target company and your name and your target companies. And I ask everybody to please look over that list and see if you can help somebody else who's on the list. For everybody here in the room, hopefully you fill out a little slip of paper over here so I know you're with us, and we'll get that updated. We'll get you an opportunity to give your 30-second introductions in just a moment. So put 30 seconds on the clock. All right, if you're still typing away, please continue typing. Don't let us stop that doing that here. What we want to do now is for everybody who's in the room here, allow them to give their 30-second introductions. So let me flip over, let me switch the camera in the room here. Give me a second. There we go. Let me turn this off. And who's got the mic? There you go.
Good morning. I'm Jim Parker. I'm an electrical engineer with good communication skills. I've spent the bulk of my career in technical sales and marketing. My broad experience and communication skills internal to the company allow me to work easily across departmental lines to make sure that things get done. External to the company, I can speak to any business or technology level with the customer to make sure that they understand the full value of the products and services my company sells. I'm currently looking for a technical sales position or technical training position. I'm Jim Parker.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Kelly Lanier. I am an account manager, a customer success manager. I am an initiator, a collaborator, and a strategizer and a relationship builder. I am the octopus in the middle. Kelly Lanier.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Jema Ball. I'm a global operations leader with 20 plus years experience in hospitality, healthcare, and SaaS platform companies. I thrive on creating order out of chaos. I'm currently seeking an executive level position in service delivery or product implementation here in the DFW area. I need contacts at Amadeus and Tyler Technologies. My name is Jema Ball.
Good morning. My name is Ann Lippert. I have been in technical sales in the water and wastewater industry for approximately 24 years. Most recently, had my own company that I passed along to my daughter, and now looking for a new adventure. Don't know exactly what I want to do or where I want to do it, but DFW area. My name is Ann Lippert.
Good morning. My name is Gina Patton. I build relationships company-wide across whether it's all stakeholders. I'm looking for a veteran liaison position or company representative position or possibly an employee trainer. My target companies are Bell Helicopter, Raytheon, and Lockheed Martin. My name is Gina Patton.
Hello, my name is Doug Maxim. I've been cybersecurity for over 20 years. I focus primarily on third-party risk management, governance, risk, and compliance. I help deploy and manage third-party risk management systems, help build their metrics so that there's upward reporting and visibility into any risks with third-party. I need contacts at Lockheed Martin and Toyota. My name is Doug Maxim.
Good morning. My name is Anthony Archery. I'm a senior retail manager / merchandiser. I have a passion to help companies drive sales and grow profit at the same time reduce costs. Anthony Archery.
Hi, my name is Phil Young. I'm a senior financial analyst and a CPA. I help senior management build their budgets and control their spending so that we can keep more people employed. My name is Phil Young.
All right. Let me readjust myself so everybody can see me. All right, that's better. Good morning, everybody. My name is William McLaughlin. I'm currently seeking a data analyst role. I do the research necessary for companies to make data-driven decisions that will help them improve the bottom line. I'm looking for contacts at NTT Data and CoreLogic. My name is William McLaughlin. Thank you very much.
Good morning. My name is Matt Keelan. I'm a senior IT leader. I help companies maximize their technology investment and keep their data safe. I need contacts at USAA and RealPage in Plano. Again, my name is Matt Keelan.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Chandler Kim. I'm a technology marketing and partnering executive, and I help companies win more and grow faster. Chandler Kim.
All right, just hold on to it because you're going to need that in just a second. We're about to pick your
okay.
All right, that's everybody here. I mean, just FYI, in case you wondered, it took such a long time. We've got 14 people here today. We've got 35 on Zoom, 5 more people on Facebook. So this is a good topic today. People are tuning in to see what we're going to talk about. All right, if you know somebody who's unemployed recently unemployed for a while, please let them know about CareerDFW and CareerUSA.org, two totally free websites. They don't collect any personal information. They're just there to help you in your job search. So if you know somebody, please let them know about the two sites and everything that's on there. Take a look. There's lots of information on there. If you find something that's not correct, please let me know so I can update it. So I'm only sharing the best information that's out there. One of the things you'll find on the careerdfw.org calendar is a bunch of calendars. And on there, we've got career fairs, training workshops that are happening. Job fairs are in pink. I just loaded a bunch of job fairs for 2024 today or this past week. Career workshops are in gold. Those meetings that are meeting in person are in blue. And for those around the United States, those in purple are webinars that are happening that you can tune in from anywhere you're at. All right. Let's talk about the practice interview team for a second. Chandler.
We all know that interviewing is a key part of landing that next role. If you're interested in trying to improve your interviewing skills or just wondering how your interview skills are, this is a wonderful opportunity to practice and actually get feedback on your interviewing skills. It's an opportunity to try to interview on a actual position that you're interested in or perhaps have already applied to. You can send an email to dallaspitcrew@gmail.com and get on the schedule, and you'll be able to go through a practice interview and get feedback and learn how you can improve your interviewing skills.
Thank you.
A wonderful free service.
Right, totally free. And one of the things the group is now doing is they are now meeting in person on the first, second, third, and fifth Wednesdays each month. The fourth Wednesday of the month, they will be online only so that anybody can watch it. But if you live in the DFW area, they're trying to get back to everybody coming in person. They're going to schedule either two or three interviews on a Wednesday. So if you want an in-person interview, just reach out to the Dallas Pit Crew. For more information, just go to www.dallaspitcrew.com. All right, let's hear about the Interview Success Workshop. Good morning, Walt.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome. And so I also like to help people with their interviewing skills, and I heartily recommend the Pit Crew. However, I suggest you do something else first. I suggest that we learn how to sell. How do you sell ourselves in an interview? What are the things that we are selling? So I'll focus on fundamentals. It's kind of like anything in sports. There is practice on fundamentals. There's footwork, example, for a quarterback. There's all different things. You watch a golfer, and they practice all the time. Before every shot, they practice. So I suggest we practice selling the fundamentals. And what are they? They are who we are, what we do, and how we help. How can we combine our characteristics, our soft skills, with our experience, knowledge, and background in order to provide value to the company, to the department, and to the position that you offer? Everyone likes to be of value in a company. So how do we sell that? So that's what the Interview Success Workshop is all about. It's free. You have to be registered to attend. If you look me up on LinkedIn, you can see all the details in the About section. That QR code on the screen will give you a start of an email to fill in a couple of pieces of information so that I can register you, send you dates of availability. I generally handle it at 9 to 11 on Central Time on Tuesdays, and higher, if demand goes up, I'll do it other days. But anyway, register to attend. Come on down. This, the difference between a pit crew, one of the major differences, and this learning interview is no stress. This is, it's just focused on learning how to sell. It's not focused on practicing and how great you are and how wonderful you are and how well you can do. It's just practicing and learning how we can do that selling piece. Then I recommend you go to the pit crew. How many times should you practice until you get comfortable? Well, you know the number. It's more than one. It's more than two. It's probably more than three. So I welcome you to sign up and register for the workshop. I call it Learning Without Squirming. So I guess you expect another poem. Maybe you already know them. To get rid of those fears, we got to get off our rears so the best candidate we can show them.
Rosine. Oh, here we go. My mic was off. Sorry about that. It's time to hear this week's career tip of the week. Good morning.
Good morning, Jeff. Good morning, everybody. Happy Friday. All right. Well, this week's tip of the week is dated January 21st, 2024. And the topic is lying during job interviews getting out of hand? This article is by Haley Minsick. So it's getting more difficult to discern whether a job candidate is being truthful or not. Most people aren't totally honest when they answer the questions like, why did you leave your previous role? Where did you see yourself in 5 years? And why do you want to work here during job interviews? In fact, a whopping 80% of workers say they've lied in a job interview before, and 44% admitted to frequently lying, according to an August survey from Resume Lab, and that's from 1,900 responders. And while skirting through the truth of job interviews is an age-old habit, there are signs that it's starting to get out of hand. Some fibs may seem harmless, but they can lead to job seekers landing roles that they're ultimately unhappy with while they become a burden to their employers. It obfuscates that if it's the right fit, and it creates an additional mismatch challenge for organizations down the line. And so at the same time, hiring managers are perhaps more distrusting than ever in believing applicants are presenting themselves accurately, as more people are using generative AI to craft their application materials like resumes and cover letters, and even answers to potential interview questions and writing assessments. Almost half of the job seekers use generative AI in job applications this year. The Resume Lab survey also found that applicants with higher education levels, those holding master's or doctoral degrees, reported the highest instances of lying in interviews, actually 85%. And that's followed by those with college degrees, 71%. Candidates with a bachelor's or associate's degree were least likely to lie at 63%. Lying about any area where they are verification mechanisms in place, like employment dates and work history, is a quick way to foment distrust and get out of the running. And lies about technical skills often come to light during assessments in the interview process. But I think the riskier areas might be on parts about culture fit and candidate expectations, like those questions that feel more innocuous. Lying about whether you think you'll fit with a company's culture and adequately manage expectations in the role can have a big impact when it comes to performance and satisfaction down the line. Even lying about where you see yourself in 5 years can come back to get you. Finding that right fit is going to be just as important as the right technical alignment. And some of the kind of more black and white box checking parameters for both candidates and their organizations. They're really looking for the right fit and the right fit for the organization long term. One main reaction to lying when responding to questions and ultimately landing a role is to accept an offer and then back out. Between May of 2022 and May of 2023, some 50% of candidates accepted a job offer that they later backed out of and then started working for another employer. And this was during a survey by Gartner, where there were over 3,000 respondents that did this. It's important to be honest, because you don't want to end up in the same position doing the things you don't want to do again and then searching for another job in 6 months. Lying about where you see yourself in 5 years is another common one that would really create a mismatch down the line. You don't want to go in and say you hope to be the vice president of an accounting department within 5 years, if truly that's not something you're aspiring to and that you're just trying to impress them. It's just so important to be honest about who you are, what you value, and what you want, so that you can find the right fit rather than just winning the job interview and getting the job. Again, thoughts to think about. This is the career tip of the week. And again, it's dated January 21, 2024. And it's is lying during job interviews getting out of hand. Have a fantastic weekend, everybody.
Thank you very, very much. And I'm sure nobody here, nobody online, and nobody here in the room has lied when you've gone into a job interview. I mean, you know, I guess you're talking about even one little itty bitty bit. So, you know, just, you know, tell the truth. You don't have to tell the god awful truth, you know, just tell the truth. All right. If you'd like to come join us for lunch today, we're going to go to Dickie's Barbecue, 4023 Preston Road in Plano. It's on Preston Road, just north of Parker, just south of Spring Creek. So if you'd like to come join us, please join us, 1145 Dickie's Barbecue. All right, just coming up in a couple of moments, we're going to hear our main event will be from Elizabeth Lyons, discovering how ChatGPT can transform your job search. I do want to mention coming up here the next couple of weeks, next week being the first Friday of the month, we will do open forum. We'll talk about whatever it is you would like to talk about. And then on February 9th, Crystal Knows. This is the, we had scheduled this a couple of weeks ago and we had no internet here in the building. So we had to cancel our meeting a couple of weeks ago, but Patty Bashe will be with us on February 9th to talk about Crystal Knows, a really interesting program. You'll definitely want to tune into this because it's got some fascinating things along with LinkedIn. All right, it's time to hear from our speaker. Where do you want to be? You want to sit here so you can just see the slides. If you want to stand up, you can stand up and do this with the microphone. You tell me where you want to be. Okay, I'll let you sit where I'm at in just a second. I will move over. Okay, let me call up her present. Give me a second here. Let me get her presentation up and running. And let me switch over to that. Make sure everybody can see what's going on here. Oh, new share. Stop share, new share. Okay, here's this. Oh, let's grab the microphone. Really, this is sort of new. Last week we had a speaker in person. This week we're doing it again. It doesn't quite happen. We don't do this. We're just sort of getting there, used to how to get back to doing this. So do you want to just introduce yourself or you want me to read what you told me to say?
No, I can introduce myself. That's fine. Are we on?
Now we're on.
There we go. Good morning. Got sound in the room. Okay. It's great to be here. It's nice to be here and in person. I'm starting to make the circuit again after I think it's been 3 years or so of not making the circuit and being all over online. So my name is Elizabeth Lyons. I am the president of Lyonsology. I wrote 3 books. Probably the one most pertinent to this group would be I Quit, Working For You Isn't Working For Me. That I have people nodding in the audience. Yep, I saw it. I saw it online. It's a good book. That's great. And then I wrote another one, which sounds like a women's leadership group, but oddly enough, apparently, I wrote a book for everyone. It's called Hear Us Roar, Unapologetic Women Leading in Corporate America. And I've had plethora of executive men buy the book and read it and give some very favorable commentary. So it's really a book about unity and leadership and getting along in the workplace. So today we're going to talk about ChatGPT and the job hunt. And I'll tell you why. I haven't seen anything out there on this. I've seen a lot of courses, even on YouTube, on ChatGPT, tons of it around engineering and AI and how to use it for coding, nothing around the job search. And it was fourth quarter last year, November, December, I had some extra time and I thought, hey, I think I'll do some classes on this. And I did some pretty extensive classes and none of them talked about the job search. When I talk to clients of mine, they say, yeah, I've used it. I'll ask them what questions I should use. And that's all they do. And so two things came to me. One, it's not out there, definitely not from my lens of 20 plus years of hiring executives. And it's not out there for job seekers. I saw that. And then I had this very deep sense that we're not using it at all or very little. And I found some data, which I'll present, that shows you we're not using it at all by demographic. So let's go to the next slide. Oh, thank you.
Ooh, should go. All right, maybe not. All right, I'll have to do it.
Okay.
Oh, wait. Try now.
There we go. So that's the slide about me. That's who I am. Oh, I think the only other thing I want to add here is what makes you a little different is I'm still hiring people after 20 some odd years. So there's a lot of coaches out there and there's a lot of noise out there. And then you start to get like, what, who's what, and what do they do, and what's their expertise? I think what makes me definitely different is that I'm still, like this morning, I provided a slate to a hiring manager of vetted candidates with my own commentary of why these would go forward. And the other 100 that applied did not. So I'm getting that feedback from managers every day, all day long. You know, the short of it is my tagline is, I know why you're hired, fired, or promoted before you do. Because I'm in the game. As a coach, what you find is many of them retire out and they've got some great expertise, but sometimes they're not still in the game. So that makes me a little bit different here. Okay, so what we're going to talk about, what is this ChatGPT? The different approach that you might want to look at and use. This is key. This is the biggest thing I learned that I'm so excited to share with all of you this morning is how you approach it is 100% what you're going to get out of it. Because a lot of people say, well, I did a prompt and it didn't really give me what I want and I zipped out of there. So I learned so much about how I approached it because, and I'll get to it, we think in Google. If you're 40 plus, we think in Google. Now we have a new tool. If you think in Google and go here, it's not going to work for you and you won't know why. And then you think it's the tool. It's not the tool. We have something to learn in how we approach it. We're going to talk about how you can get an edge on the search and prompts. And I haven't seen anything out there on this. And so I took a lot of time to really create prompts that you can walk away with and use today to plug in there and get some input. Because I will tell you, you're only as good as your prompts in ChatGPT. So what is this thing exactly? And I think that's the start. What is it? How does it work, right? So what it does, it pulls from text, articles, and content based on what is learned by a human. A human still programs this. So you'll see ChatGPT and there's Bard. You know, there's some other ones coming up. And it'll be interesting to see in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, who's got the lion's share of it because the other tools will drop off. So it is still, you know, plugged in, if you will, inputted by a human. Eventually that will take off and it will learn on its own. But the interesting thing is we don't know what it doesn't know, right? So if a human is programming this, it's only as good as the human. You're also going to see online some interesting commentary around bias. ChatGPT is biased towards white men, engineers. And so now you've got all these other diverse groups going, I don't like, this isn't all the information. I'm not getting all the information. So there's some interesting commentary around bias around the tool. And they're very sensitive to that and actually starting to work on that. So here's some interesting facts. This is what I was talking about. People aren't using it. It was just like a deep intuition. Like I'm talking to people, they're not using it. I hardly used it. I've took a bunch of classes and learned it myself. Well, US and India use it the most. So in the world, those two countries use it the most. 24% of Americans have never used ChatGPT whatsoever. 18 to 34 uses it the most, that demographic. 60% of the users are under 34 years old. And if you're 45 to 54, which is really my client base, very few have used it, 9.3%. 9.37% have used it. Now, if you get older than that, you get 55 to 64, it drops off to a little over 5%. And if you're over 65, 3% use it. And interestingly enough, they'll use it for different reasons. So, but what they found was the bounce rate is huge. People get on there an average of 7 minutes and they're out of there. Well, they're out of there because the commentary is, it doesn't give me what I want, or I got some of it, but I didn't get all of it, so I bounced off. What I'm really excited to show you is if you approach it in a way, it will give you what you want. Any scientist will tell you how you approach the experience or how you approach that experiment in the lab is how you're going to pull the results, is how you're going to pull your data. And this is the same way in how you know, when you click it open, where are you going with it? So here's some do's and don'ts. So the biggest thing I had to learn, because I was kind of the master at Google and I'm the master at finding people. I'm actually the master at finding out if you're lying online. I'm really good at that. But you have to think extremely detailed and you have to think of it as if you're talking to a person And in Google, we just do broad strokes and wheedle down from there. So we'll say, like, what is the common cold? You know, what does this company do, right? Real broad in Google. If you try that broad approach with this tool, that's why the bounce rate is high. It's not going to give you what you want. So you don't want to ask broad questions. You want to get pretty detailed. Again, you want to pretend it's a person or your personal assistant. You can ask for all kinds of things. I'll hear people say, oh, I took a document or an email, I plunked it in there, it rewrote it for me. You can actually use it for travel. You can actually, like, what airport is closest to this city in Florida? I'm going to Florida. What are the three things I should say? So you can use it lots of different ways. Contracts, it's usually done. And be careful with that. There was some attorney, a young gun attorney, that actually submitted a case for law, and ChatGPT made up a bunch of data that wasn't true, and it went all the way to the judge, and the kid lost his job because he didn't verify his facts. He threw it in there. So it's a very careful thing if you're an attorney, I'll tell you that. Emails can go through there. Your job search can go through there. You want to play with your prompts, and I'll show you how to do that. And you can always ask, can you do it again? Is there another way to say this? Can you try this again? What do you think? Could you I've done that 2 and 3 times, and it'll go, sure, and it'll give me others. Then if you say it very specifically, can you rewrite this for a professional level audience from 40 to 55? Boom, I get a very perfect answer. Do you see what I mean by detailed instead of broad? So you have to think about your end goal. Who am I saying this to? What is my intent? Where am I going? Who is my audience? If you really think of that, you get better usage of it. You want to use it for a couple of things and try. You know, I would say keep using it, keep getting used to it, keep looking at the answers it's giving you, and keep massaging it through. Don't trust it for everything, and always verify your facts. So for instance, in the job search, if I had a company that I was going to interview for, you know, I might Google the company first, but then I would ask ChatGPT, tell me about this company, see if it pulls something a little different, but verify those facts. If it's telling you something totally different, then flag, it's probably not accurate. So it's just something to think about. So that was my whole point here. ChatGPT is not Google. And I think that is the biggest mind shift that we need to make if we're 40 plus. If you go with broad questions, you're not going to get what you want. If you go with very detailed questions, you're going to get more hits than misses. If you ask it a detailed question, it gives you a bunch of scenarios, then you can say, those are pretty good. Give me 5 more. And they will. So for example, when I wrote the abstract for this talk, I put it in there and I said, I don't know what to call this. What would you call this? And so it gave me 10 titles for this talk. And I was like, those are pretty good. I like these too. Can you give me 5 more? And then it gave me some more. So you can keep prompting it and asking it to drill down. Now, what I did find was sometimes that drill down is just, it's just more recirculated garbage. It didn't work. It wasn't unique. It wasn't any catchier. And by the third time I was bouncing out of there. But try it. That's what I mean. Like, really, like, get in your mind, okay, I'm going to sit with this thing and I'm going to try to figure out how it works, what it does. If you go into it with that, I think you're going to have a better experience. The beauty of this presentation is I did a lot of the work for you, and I'm really excited to share that around the job search. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, that's true. Let's. Yes, IP.
Repeat his comment. Oh, yes. People can add. Well, no, hold on.
Yeah.
Hold on.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The point I was making on the slide previously that had IP is an issue means intellectual property, not internet protocol. Yep, there it is. Yep.
That's an excellent call out, and I thank you. I work with high-level tech professionals, security people. You know, that's who my audience is, and that's a great point. It is all about intellectual property. So what is owned there? So here's how you might use it for your job search. Again, working with clients, even they will say, hey, I'll run that through ChatGPT. Okay, what are you running through there? Well, I want to know what interview questions they could ask me. Now, I will tell you from the research I've done, it's pretty accurate. The clients I had that used it in that way, it would spit out five questions that they would be asked in the interview. And the commentary was three were correct and dead on. And the other two were just good to train and understand. So I thought, okay, there's something there to that. So you could do it for company research. Again, I would verify some facts, maybe cross-reference it, triangulate it against another tool, go to the company's website, Google, and maybe here, right? Or maybe you go in here and you say, what do I not know about this company I'm interviewing for? What would you tell me that's different? That's a specific prompt, right? And see what it gives you. You can use it for interview prep. You could use it for resume polish. And now I want to talk about lying. And now I want to talk about our tip of the day in lying. So there's a lot of people that take their resume and they throw it through ChatGPT, and it is fantastic. And you may or may not get through the applicant tracking pool. Like you may or may not get, like you could apply with that resume and you may or may not get called to interview. And I want to be very specific on this day in January in 2024. Here's how it works. A real person will read your resume. Someone like me will read a resume. It is not automated yet. In my job, every day, all day long, there's not some tool that tells me, here's 10 candidates, Elizabeth, call them. Not yet. I don't know when that will happen. I don't know if that can happen due to discriminations in law. I don't know. It might be an adjunct tool that we will be forced or told to use in a year or two. And I'm guessing on that timeline because it would be augmented into the pool of candidates we're already considering and like an add-on tool. But for right now, if you throw your resume through ChatGPT and have it rewritten, you may get a call, you may not. It's not a set thing because there's a lot of people that are like, oh, this is my magic bullet. No, my point is you're not going to dodge a person. And I think we're all looking for quick fixes. And it goes back to that lying piece. ChatGPT may embellish a bit on your resume. So I would say truthful on your resume because you're going to have to speak to that. Not saying don't use it. I'm just trying to give you the broad picture of what's happening today up here in the market. It's great for salary negotiations. Hey, how do I ask for more money? My client recently wrote in there, actually, I did it for her. What is a fair market price for a CMO role in Atlanta, Georgia? What would I be paid? And it came up with a range. That's great, right? Now you know going in kind of where you should be about, right? It's not going to be, don't get upset if you go out with a number and employer says no, because it's going to be based on their budget and internal equity. So like in my job, I pull internal equity on everybody in the company. So I know what the 50% is within that band range, within that job. However, I would still look at it in that because I think it's a great tool for that. And it's better than clunking around salary.com and some of these other tools because they're going to give you a range, but then it's based off the high in New York and California. And then it's based off of the low in Iowa, right? And so you get these numbers that are a little bit wonky, frankly. So I think it's great for salary negotiation. I think it's great for professional development. There's some security people in the room. What kind of certificate should I get in security? What are the up and coming certs that I should be looking at in 2024? I already have my CISP and my CISA. What else do you suggest given that I'm applying for this role? Do you see what I mean? Specific. All my tech people in the room, specific. Certs are great to ask it. It'll give you some idea. Again, verify, verify, verify. If you're in security, ISACA, it should be your best friend. Definitely bounce it off there, be poking around their site and see what they have to say about that too. Thank you notes. It does write some very nice thank you notes. I did see that as well. So here's some prompts that you could use. So if let's say you did want to put your resume through there, you could say, analyze the keywords. Oh, I have a typo there. Analyze the keywords in the job post and see how my resume matches. So you're going to take your job posting, cut, paste. You're going to take your resume, cut, paste, and say, show me the keywords here and what matches. Show me what's missing. And it will tell you. Now you've got a better shot of going back, of taking that resume, adding those few skill sets and buzzwords, you know, putting that in your resume and then sending that off. You've got a better chance in terms of somebody like me reading it and being like, yep, they're qualified. I definitely want to call them for an interview. You can ask it to rewrite to maximize keywords. You could have them look at your skill section or your summary at the top. You know, in this, in our resumes now, you know, I'm a mid-level executive with XYZ, and this, you can take, it's fantastic. You take that, plunk it in there and say, hey, rewrite this for an executive who might hire me. That's a great way to use it. You can say, act as if you are an ATS and review my resume to this job posting. You could say, write a resume. It's got to be 2 pages, use an active voice, and highlight my accomplishments. Now, look at that last prompt. Do you see how specific that is? So again, the thinking I want to go over, it's a person. It's like your personal assistant or your personal administrator or an expert. It's like a conversation rather than Google, where you're just doing these broad things. What is, who is, how much? This is a little bit, it's a different way of approaching it and different way of thinking.
Do you want questions now or you want to wait to the end?
I'll take them at the end because okay. I might answer them.
Okay.
And I do want to counter this by saying I'm not a ChatGPT expert. I've just done a lot of searching and I created this for all of you. Interview prompts. Here's some things you can ask. What are the common interview questions that might be asked by a CFO? So if you're an accounting person, you know, your final interview is going to be with the CFO. You could ask that. Whatever you think your highest rank is going to be in that interview, you can ask it that. What are the 5 most common interview questions for this title? For this title, that's important. Who might interview me for a job if I'm an accountant? Okay, it could be the accountant manager. It could be the CFO. It could be, you know, it could be the CEO if it's a small company. So it's going to tell you who's the title. Because remember, their title is also going to be their orientation into the interview, right? So if I'm a CFO and I'm interviewing a CMO, I'm a financial person. So I want to know how that marketing person gives me data to show me if that marketing is working and really turning into sales for my company. So you're disciplined like me, right? Like I'm talent acquisition. I'm also an entrepreneur. I'm a coach. So my lens is going to be different than, say, an HR person that would interview you that doesn't do talent acquisition all the time, right? Or my lens might be different than a regular recruiter. I've been a technical recruiter for executives for over 20 years. So my lens is going to be different. So the titles matter. That's going to be their lens when they ask you questions. That's going to be what's important to them as they ask you in the interview. And then I always end with, what else can I ask you, ChatGPT? What else is missing? Any other thoughts? And it will pause and then it will spit out. It's pretty interesting tool. Salary prompts. So let's say you want to use it for salary. So what are some strategies for negotiating to know if my salary range is fair? What are the salary ranges for this position in a large publicly traded company? What would be my salary range for this job title within a private company? What would be my salary range for this within a tech company? Again, specific. You'll actually get different numbers. And I can tell you for a fact, you will get different numbers. Google is going to pay higher than another company, right? Because that's a tech company. That's different. Google is definitely going to pay higher than a small private company of 50 million, right? So you want to get some idea of what that band is as you're interviewing to understand their budget. How can I research and determine if my salary range is accurate? So it may give you some sources there. It might pull from sources online and give it to you. And that's a great way to kind of look at salary. But these are prompts I would literally type in. Now that's what I'm giving you, prompts. Literally you could type those in, you could walk away and work with these. Development prompts. So professional development. What are some classes I should take given this job title? And I've been doing it for 20 years or 10 years or 5 years. What are the most common certificates for, say, a security engineer or, you know, whatever your discipline is? What are some of the most competitive certs that I should investigate for this job? Sometimes on the job posting, it'll say, if you have your, I'm going back to security, if you have your CISO or CSUM, that would be great or highly desirable. but sometimes they're good certs that you might want to have. If you have them, you want to make sure you highlight that and talk about that in the interview. And then thank you notes. Write a thank you note expressing gratitude for the interview. So it's not write a thank you note. It's tone. ChatGPT will pick up tone. So gratitude, write it for this audience. Write it with this tone. Write a thank you note for executives to read after my interview. Act as if you're receiving the thank you note from an applicant. How would I write the thank you note to express how sincere I am about the job? Specific, specific, specific. So I'm going to go on a tangent here. I have an Achilles heel about thank you notes. Thank you notes should be gratitude. It should be gratitude for my time. Like I just told you about one rec. One. I hired almost 100 people last year. One rec. 100 people's resumes I read. 15 of them got to talk to me. 8 of them got cut from there. They're going to go to final interviews in 2 weeks. So when you write me a thank you note, which is an email that just goes on about how you should deserve the job and your great skill set, I've deleted you out. Like, where's the gratitude in that? There's none. It's all about you. And the I, me, mine, forcing it in the recruiter's face is very difficult. You know, it's our job. Yes, it's our job to do this. But your approach to recruiters, just like ChatGPT, what you do is what you're going to get back. So I have a real thing about thank you notes. They should not be a reiteration of your skill set. It's kind of calling me an idiot. Like I didn't listen the first time and take notes. I did. Right. And you're overselling at this point. Like I know who you are. You know, when I get really sincere thank you notes, it's like once every 2 years. And usually it's one line. You know, it's tough. So, and I get you want your salary replaced. I understand your sense of urgency. I get it. But the approach and the process is 100% what you're gonna get out. It's 100% what your experience will be. You know, those that talk about ageism and all these things, how I'm treated, I have to ask, how are you approaching it? Are you expecting it? Are you expecting to be treated this way? What's going on in your self-talk? So the thank you notes to me are critical. And when I threw them through these, they're pretty good. They had gratitude. And I was like, oh my gosh, this really is like talking to a person. So future outlook. First of all, we don't know anything. This is so new. And honestly, this is really my passion, my blood, sweat, and tears, and frankly, my own panic and not knowing this tool. Because this has been going online forever about this ChatGPT and AI. And it was November and it was quiet. And I was like, I better learn this stuff. And then I realized all of you don't know it either. So really, this is just, it's like my offering to you in hours of trying to figure this out and develop prompts that I know will work. But we don't know anything. And I always like to say, I'm not an expert. And this is of January 2024. This whole thing could change in 3 months, you know? Who knows? Bard could be the thing. Who knows? But I think if you walk away today and try it and try to embrace it, I think you're going to get some success for sure. So what we think we're going to see with AI is you're going to see it plugged into recruiting. So remember earlier I told you I'm not forced. I'm not given 10 candidates that I have to call when I open a rec. That's now in the future, it might be an augmented tool that I like you'll apply, but there's an augmented tool that says, hey, Elizabeth, here's 10 other qualified candidates that we found that are passive. Give them a call. Right now, it's not in there. They did talk about using AI to automate the onboarding and offboarding process, which would be phenomenal. Now, here's the thing. We deeply need our IT people to make sure they cut access, because I was reading the other day that a lot of times the access isn't cut and there's like tens of thousands of millions of dollars that's spent because they think they're cut from payroll, but they still have access to all these other systems as a user. But they are looking at, and that would be nice to kind of automate onboard and offboard. I remember when automation started and I didn't care for it, but they will. I think AI will start to do that and you're going to start to see that. The only place you're going to see a real person is to verify your I-9. By United States American law, I have to physically verify that you handed me your license or your passport, and I'm physically verifying you are that person. It's a lot. But that would mean in your onboarding, you're going to see one person for a few minutes, and that's kind of it. Everything else is going to be an email, a link you click on and you access. And then they go, if that link doesn't work, call IT. Good luck. And it's very panicking because you're a new employee and you're like, oh my God, my computer won't work. But that's just how we're doing it. And the same thing will be with the offboarding they're predicting as well. There's definitely ethical considerations with all this. There's a lot of hubbub about that in the press. I kind of keep an eye on it just to kind of see where it's going to go in terms of fairness, equity. It's not slanted one way or the other. It's not bias, et cetera. They're also talking about looking for predictive analytics for talent acquisition. So predicting where's the talent pool going to be in the future, you know, where it lies now, does it lie all in California? You know, is it in Montana? That those sorts of things to help us to find talent and identify them and bring them in. So this is my slide about coaching. So I would say don't go it alone. So for this, any group where I speak live or, and I've known Jeff for like over a decade, I realize that, bam, we have known each other a minute, sir, a long time. So for these groups, I always say, if you want to do a 15-minute coaching laser session, just drop me an email or text me. Hey, Elizabeth, I'd like to do that. You want your resume reviewed. You're scared about something. You know you have an interview. You want to do a little prep. Any of that, I'm more than happy. I always like to give back and do that for these groups. And anybody who's on Facebook as well, you could reach out to me too. You could check out the site at Lionsology. And you know, coaching is a very individual thing. You know, it's not, a lot of people don't need it. I do a lot of these calls and I'm like, try this, you'll be fine. But if you want something deeper, then we can talk about that as well. Mm-hmm. And that's all I had.
Okay. Well, we've got some questions online. Richard says, what do you think about Bard, Google's AI?
I don't have any thoughts. I just focused on the ChatGPT because I spent a lot of hours doing this. It would just be like more hours. So I don't know, but I would keep an eye on them. I would definitely keep an eye on them.
All right. Let me see. Let me turn on the camera here. Let's see here. Next question. Does the ATS application rank resumes based on keywords or phrases?
Neither. So remember, we talked about, I shared a person reads your resume. So the most important thing is the qualifications of the law, especially now. It's always been like that, but it's a real hot topic now. There are companies with recruiters. We are audited at the back end of the rack. An audit team will come in and make sure that your qualifications, your resume matches the qualifications of the job. So it's not necessarily keywords. So to make it very simple, go to the qualifications, make sure those are on the resume. Go to the desired, if you have those skills, make sure that's up at the top of the resume, bubble those up. And there's a very, very good likelihood that you would get a call.
All right. Tamara says, and I don't really understand the question, does it understand the term keywords? You've got keywords and quotes. Tamara, do you want to give us any more of a what you're asking here?
Sure, there was a slide where you were asking ChatGPT for the keywords in a job description. I was just wondering if it understood the word keywords or if you... Yes.
Every prompt I gave you, I checked.
Okay, so it was precisely that was quoted. Okay, thank you.
Yep, you bet.
Great, all right. Let's see here. Can others... Mark says, can other people see the questions you are asking on ChatGPT?
Oh, wait, that's a trick question. I got to go back to my training. I got to think about that because I want to say that, well, if you don't erase them, even if you erase them, they're back there in the tool somewhere. And yes, as I recall, when we were going through the classes around IP, there was that, you know, your stuff could be recycled and used back into the tool with your own questions or information. So can a person like zoom in and see like you, your employer, whatever? No, that's not it. But could your stuff be reused or recycled through the tool? As I recall, my classes, yes.
Questions in here? Or
yeah.
Questions right here.
Oh, I would just go right to Google and type in ChatGPT and it'll go ChatGPT AI. There's a paid version and a non-paid version. Just do the non-paid version. The paid version is $20. It operates faster. It will maybe give you a little bit more. It's the most current. But you for right now, for what you're doing, you could do the unpaid and it's fine. It'll say, it might say AI open source. That's the one. I just clicked on that, created an account in less than 5 minutes. And every time I pull it in, it knows who I am. I go right back into my account. Yeah, you're welcome.
Other questions?
Yeah, go ahead. Hey, Matt.
I was surprised about your comment about thank you notes. How do I resist the temptation to re-summarize our conversation to remind them about my qualifications in addition to being gracious?
Yeah, that's a great question. He's like, I still want to tell you. I don't want to not tell you. I get anxious about that. So here's some gold. I mean, gold. You're in the interview. At the end of the interview, you say, you know, it just occurred to me, you're probably going to interview 5 or 6 other people. Here are the 3 things you need to know about me that makes me different in my candidacy. And I was in search and I did that. And I gave it to all my clients and they did that. And for your laser session, you can show me your thank you note and I could look at it and give you a little feedback and coaching around that if you'd like. So, because that's the reality. And I think really that's where Matt's question stems from, is fear in, I'm just going to drown out in the noise. You're not going to remember me. And if I'm on Zoom, you may not remember me. If I'm in person, there's a better chance you're going to remember me. So his question stems from a little bit of fear of like, I don't want to get lost behind. I don't want you to forget me. So I found that that's the magic thing. And then I was the executive that was hiring for my team. And when I did interview 8 people, yeah, I mean, I was like, okay, I have to ascertain what's unique about them versus the other 8. But when you tell me in the interview, here are the 3 things you might want to know about me. It works like a charm. And then the thank you note, it can be just gratitude. And there's a piece of trust the process. You know, you will land. It's a process. You're not a product. You're not a box of cereal that we're trying to sell. You're not a car we're trying to sell. You're a process. It's a process. It's all a process. And I think that takes the sting of rejection out, because you're just in a process. Oh, this one didn't work. Now I've got a second interview here. It stops them from riding these highs and lows of the job search. That's why I do what I do, because that pains me, because it's unnecessary. But that's the other thing I would say, is write it, let it go, trust the process. You cannot have a job that isn't meant for you. It's like not possible. If it's meant to be your job, it's going to be your job.
Question.
Yeah. Go ahead, Walt. Here, go on.
So I'm an older guy, and when I was introduced to technology, we were using paper tape and punch cards for input and output in machines. And so here's this new tool that's come along. And so I have just some concerns of saying, is what I'm writing and what I'm presenting really me? And so I want to look at that and say, because you look and say, oh, you write pretty well. But then I get on the job, I can't write that well. You know, and so I'm not really representing some of the things that might come through that other than what I'm trying to do. And so I want to just make sure, I guess it's a suggestion to everybody, that make sure that your final product represents you. It's what you would say. It's how you should. They're just maybe tweaking the words a little bit, which is fine. But don't come out and, you know, I'm worried about misrepresenting myself and what the products be. And every time we use another crutch to hire rather than just talking to somebody, I get a little worried about that, because I think, and you've heard me say it before, I'll have my computer talk to your computer.
So he raises a good point. So I want to go back to the process. It's a self-flushing process. You write a whiz-bang resume, as Walt says, then they're going to think I'm a good writer. Somebody like me still has to interview you. An executive still has to hire you. HR has to still hire you. So we still have people in the process. So if they do, he's got a great concern. I thought the same thing, but it's going to get flushed out in the interview. So, and we're seeing that with the tech professionals. You look at dev people, all they'll write, and then you get on screen, it falls apart rapidly. So you are who you are. This is just, is this going to give you an edge or make it a little prettier? Yeah. But ultimately, he's right. Who you are is who you are. The process, trust the process. Anybody else?
Yeah, I see a hand up. Anis, you want to ask?
Yes, sir. Can everyone hear me? Hopefully. Okay, thank you. My question pertains to ChatGPT 3.5 versus 4. And I think the presenter, and I can't see her face, you had mentioned that you recommended 3.5, but I pretty much punched in the question while you were talking about what's a reasonable median salary range for a person of my role. And ChatGPT 3.5 said its last update was Jan 2022, and it does not have the needed background. I put in the same question in Claude, Anthropic, and it gave me a number. So I thought that was interesting, frankly, and I was wondering if I need to pay the $20 a month to get to ChatGPT-4 if the two-year difference is really a big factor. Thank you.
In terms of salaries, I want to think about this before I answer it, because we're talking now about post-pandemic. In the pandemic, people could go out and get literally 25 to 40, 50% increases. And so if we're looking at that data, it's high. And when I have another presentation where I talk about the economy and the job search, and companies now really are looking at, considering inflation and everything else, we probably overpaid for the skill set. So what does the skill set really command? So when you're getting into numbers like that, and I love that you looked at three different tools. Oh my gosh, like, thank you for being that person in the group, because I didn't have time to do that. I think what you did was brilliant. So you're looking at three different tools, and I think you're getting different information. I think that is your key. If you want to pay the $20 a month, you probably could. Would you get deeper data or more relevant? Yeah, but I've read something recently that they're going to be updating ChatGPT. Like, it's like within the first quarter, they're going to update it again. So I think it depends what you want. And if it wasn't post-pandemic, I would say it's probably not going to matter a year or two. But because the wages did what they did, the stock market did what they did, employers did what they did, I think that, yeah, it may be off, to be honest with you. I don't know that I would look at that number. And we're seeing companies pulling back in 2024 and really examining, you know, what is the skill set really, how much does it really cost? That's the question. Like, what, like, somewhere in between what we used to pay and post-pandemic is where we should be, but nobody knows what that is. So they're trying to figure that out. I hope I answer your question.
Good. Thank you. Appreciate
you. You're welcome.
Yeah, if you are using ChatGPT, the original version, it was loaded up through like March or April of 2022, right, or 2021.
Hi, this is Doug Maxim. I just wanted to make a comment. Someone asked a question about how ChatGPT uses your data. And when you go to the site to sign up, at the very bottom, there's terms of use and privacy policy. The privacy policy is very detailed in how they use the data, and what Elizabeth described does happen. It's called de-identifying or aggregating data, which removes any identifying content from your data. But anyway, those are there at the bottom of the sign-in page.
That's good to know. Go ahead.
Okay.
Following on to that, there is a privacy setting in ChatGPT. If you are not wanting to have your information stored, you can go into their settings, and they have the equivalent of Chrome's incognito mode. You won't see previous things show up in your history, but it is a way to prevent them from using your info.
Yeah. See, I don't have to know it all. There's value in the group. And I love when I talk to some tech in the audience. So thank you all for your contributions.
Any other questions from somebody? If you're online, you can just unmute your mic and ask. Mike?
Yeah, this is Mike Ray. Yesterday, we had a speaker who said, my time is as important as the person doing the interview. And I don't want to devalue my worth by saying thank you for your time. How do you show an attitude of gratitude and avoid devaluing my time?
Well, I think thank you notes should be just that. And I think thank you notes are also not words. It's the intent behind the words that's moving behind the words. It's always your intent behind the words, whether you're in a conversation with me or talking to your dog or in an interview. So, and that intent does get registered and that intent does get felt by the reader on some level. So I think I would say that. And then I would say everyone's time is important. No one's time is more important than another, whether it's me or the executive or the job seeker. But it's like being invited into someone's house, right? You're the guest and you just show gratitude and graciousness for their offering. And the only thing they have to offer you is information about the job and their time. So to thank them for that, I think that's a good place to start. And I think also, you know, saying things like, I'm sincerely interested in your company, and leave it at that. It should not be a regurgitation of the skills necessarily. A thank you is thank you. And we feel it. We know. So you can do what you want with that.
Did you have something? Okay, thank you.
So I have a general question that I'm going to use as a specific example, and that is your level of confidence, having used it, when you are asking ChatGPT to provide unverifiable data, because we talked before about you should always cross-reference. So as an example, piggybacking off of Anant's question about salary, private company salary and things like that, not really verifiable or cross-verifiable. You get a result back, you know, that's part of the mindset and positioning for salary negotiation, but you can't verify it. Is the data you've seen that comes from ChatGPT kind of, is it accurate enough that you're confident you can say, oh, well, you know, I know what my market value is for this role. And okay. Yeah. Thank you.
That was a great question. I want to add to that as well. So you're going to want to consider, when it gives you the range, you're going to want to consider, is it a private company or a public company? That would be number one. You want to also consider that you don't know internal equity. So that was a good point too, because you don't know what their internal equity is. And you know that that went up probably to that 50 percentile or maybe higher during pandemic. And if they did not have attrition, that number so may be on the higher end. But generally speaking, so you're not all wound up about it, the range is the range and they would be pretty accurate. And I think it's good. I mean, I think you're gonna be in there. And if the range, that high range, let's say you ran it through three tools and that high range is like huge, throw it out, right? So when you have, you guys are data people, you know, when you're looking at data that's like wonky one end or the other, I hate this, I love this, I have to have it, you throw those out. You're looking at kind of the medium and you know what you are paid, right? And so then you'll know kind of where you need to be in there. So I would go with that.
You know, and I always tell people when you're telling the range is that you give them a range and say, and I'm sure that whatever your company is going to pay will be fair and equitable, because
yes,
what company's not going to do that? And you know, you'll find out.
So when I had my interview, and I'm looking at Matt and talking to Matt, when I had my interview, when we were in negotiation, and I did that, here's three things you want to remember about me. And I could hear he was writing that down. When we got into negotiations, I remind them in a very nice way why they would buy my skill set. So I would say things like, I might not be for everybody, but if you hire me, this is what, like flat out, this is what you're paying for. Like you're paying for my network, you're paying for this, you're paying for my experience, you're paying. So when you're looking at your other people, that's what you're paying for this. And I literally said this, and I don't know where it came from. It wasn't even boldness. I just said, please be generous. And oh boy, they were generous. And I let it go and they were generous. So, and this is gold. Like this stuff, I can't tell you how much gold I'm throwing at you right now. So try it. Like, why would they write the price ticket X for you versus the other? It's okay to respectfully, professionally remind them that X factor that you bring to the game.
Question?
Yeah.
Hi. I really like your idea on the thank you notes, putting gratitude into it. That kind of gives me a North Star on it. One thing I've heard is sometimes during the interview, you don't give a very good answer and you want to try to follow up with them. And I've heard like embedded in the thank you note is, Okay. That's yeah. So that's my.
Wait, take your mic. You can only talk. Only say something.
I said, no, don't do that. It's, you know, I think there it goes again. I understand where that fear and that, oh my gosh, I have to do this perfectly comes in. And then you come back and you rethink answers or you rethink what you should have, could have, would have said. Prep, do your best, take a deep breath and just be you and trust the process. What you think is glaring may not be at all. What you think is like, oh, I could have said that better, or I forgot to tell him this. And then you try to go into the thank you note. I wouldn't do that. I would just leave it. It'll all work out. In the end, it all shakes out. It'll all work out.
All right, a couple questions online. Lisa says, did you say a thank you note via email is okay versus sending it via post office?
Most companies now, you cannot get their addresses. Like you, in the last couple companies, you would never, ever get to me personally unless you stalked me, and that they would find you and probably grab you in the parking lot if you're stalking me. The security is pretty steep where I worked. So a thank you note and email is fine. You will also, chances are, not have that email address. You'll have to go back to the recruiter or their administrator and ask politely for that, or ask that they pass it along. They will always forward it. So if they're like, no, due to security, we don't want to give that, you can write it and say, would you just please pass my gratitude along?
All right. See, Kelly says, in your opinion, how long should a post-interview thank you note be?
This is my opinion. And I would throw it through ChatGPT and then say, now say it in 2 lines. Now say it in 3 lines. But honestly, I mean, it's thank you, right? Like if you're going on at nauseam, I picked that up too. Now it doesn't feel sincere. You know, I think it should be in and out. I think it should feel sincere. I think it should read sincere.
All right. Let's see here. And if you have another question about prompts.
Yes, sir. From everything I've read online, it almost seems like ChatGPT is this really fussy virtual person where the questions have to be exactly just so. And unfortunately, I don't think like ChatGPT. I think like a human being.
Yeah.
Is there a guide on prompts? People talk about prompt engineering and such. How should I use ChatGPT? I mean, is it that hard to work with the tool? Your thoughts?
Yeah, I'm so grateful you're on this call because you really are like got me stretching and thinking and operating at a high level here. So I would say, yes, it is fussy. I would say the biggest thing I learned was not the tool. I learned how to approach it. And maybe Bard or some of the other ones are different. But then I always wonder, well, where are they getting their sources from too? I don't know. But it is very specific. The prompts, that's why I wrote all the prompts for you, because I thought if I just gave a high level here, I could just do more service to everybody if I got ask it these things, and then you can go do that. So yeah, it is fussy. It is specific. But if you're patient with it, you can learn how to reframe it or to keep asking it to see what else is there. But I agree with you. Is it kind of fussy and specific? I totally agree with you. And for a tech person like yourself, yeah, it's like, it's too much work. But remember, it's only as good as what's plugged in there. Maybe it's fantastic after the update. You know, I don't know. We don't know. So it's kind of fun. It's kind of exciting.
And I think the important thing you said was treat this like if you're talking to your personal assistant,
yeah,
because you have to tell your personal assistant, I need a 200 word thank you note. I need a 100-page, yep, you know, 2-page resume. You've got to give your assistant
details
of what you want.
Right. So it's how you think about it. But his point was like, it's fussier than the other ones. And like, it's a little more persnickety than the other tools. And yeah, it probably is, but it's good to, you're going to get specifics out. Is my point. And if you like the other tools, then go try those. These prompts might work perfectly well and those other tools as well.
All right, I see here. Nola says, I believe you can ask GPT to provide sources and citations. Yes, you can. But if you saw the 60-minute piece last summer all about this, the host asked them to give us a 2-page something and they quoted 5 books. They said, give me 5 books it's talking about. ChatGPT made up the 5 books,
yeah,
and the citations. So you've got to trust, you've got to verify anything that you find.
Well, that's why I was asking the
That's why he asked the salary question. Yeah.
Well, I mean,
you need a range.
Yeah, you go to Bureau of Labor and Statistics.
Right.
There you go. And that's where you can get, you know, to be verified.
It's still going to be close-ish. I mean, salary ranges are anywhere between a $20,000 and a $50,000 spread. And then you get into geocode, and then you get into how big is the company in revenue. That's why I'm like, it'll still give you some good information. You can at least look at those numbers back up. You know what you are paid. Then you can get some sense of the range from the company and then be able to go in there appropriately. I think it's going to be close enough, but I would verify it.
Any other questions? Questions?
No, lots to think about.
Lots to think about. Can we send this presentation out to everybody?
Or you just want the
I'll copy just the
maybe the prompts, because I'm going to have to update it and it's gonna change. And so it's kind of my own IP here. So this is the only time in 20 years I was like, don't give the deck out. Don't give the deck out.
Okay.
So.
All right. I'll copy all the prompts, put them onto a Word document and send it out this afternoon so everybody can have those prompts.
Yep.
To do that.
No recording.
Can the presentation be, can it okay to be recorded?
Or yeah.
Can it?
No, it's okay that it's recorded. I just don't want the slides out there.
Okay. So no slides. So y'all be able to go back and watch it. You'll be able to tell other people about it if you'd like.
Because I invited about a half a dozen people that might catch that recording. So perfect. We'll have at least the recording up maybe a month or two, and then we can yank it down.
Right. All right. Any last questions before we move on? Oh, questions. Here we go. Come on up so you can get the mic.
Thank you. I wanted to ask you about a technique I use with ChatGPT and a resume. What I do is I don't put in like my whole resume. I work on a section and then like I write it and then I go to ChatGPT and say like, what do you think kind of deal. It seems like that approach makes more sense, because if you just put in your whole resume, you're not going to like. I mean, I just want to get your feedback on it.
I've seen people write books and take two paragraphs out of their book and say, please rewrite this or please correct any typos. So he's saying, would you batch the resume rather than throwing it all in and having it rewrite all of it? So yeah, that's a fine approach too. And then you can tweak it from there. If you like how it's written, you can say, you know, well, write it for a technical audience, write it for a non-technical, just see what else it gives you and play with it that way.
Yep. One word.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure that I end up getting this right. You just you go to Google and just type in ChatGPT and they'll say free, et cetera, right? Is that correct?
Click on the link and then it'll open it up and then it'll be free. It'll be the free copy.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. That's what I want to know. Thank
You're
you. Welcome.
All right. I think we're all ready.
Last call.
Lots to think about. Thanks for having me.
Well,
was there one online we missed?
Hold on. Let me see here.
I have a question, Jeff. I don't know if you can hear me.
Yep.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. How do you get around the limit of the 4,000 characters sometimes when you want to, you know, put in like a job description? Can you like only put parts of it and tell ChatGPT to read the next part? I always get confused on that part.
Never had any problem with a job description or a resume. So either it's under 4,000 characters or it doesn't matter. And I bet you anything, the paid version, I'm almost positive it's not maybe character sensitive. I'd have to check on that. But
yeah.
When I did it, I had no problem.
Okay.
All right. Well, Elizabeth, thank you very, very much. Thank you very much for your time.
Sure.
Let me share a few more slides and we'll get out of here today. Next week, we'll be doing open forum. So join us next Friday. Whatever questions you've got about your job search, and everybody can offer feedback, and we'll run around the mic and we'll just be running around like crazy here next Friday. So come join us for that. If you have not put your 30-second introductions into the chat window, please do so. Let me know your name, phone number, email address. If I don't have that information, I won't be able to send you the prompts that are going to come out this afternoon. So in addition, you'll also get a copy of the roster, and you'll be able to see everybody who's active, and you'll be able to see all the alumni of this group. So please make sure your contact information is in the chat window so that I can update that. CareerDFW and Career USA, we're putting on training 4 days a week. Please join us next Tuesday, for LinkedIn Tuesdays. Kurt Vondemotter will be with us. He's going to talk about LinkedIn from a recruiter's eye. Kurt pays the big, big bucks for LinkedIn, and he will show us what it looks like from the back end when he's trying to find you using LinkedIn Recruiter. So come join us for that. Next Wednesday, the practice interview team will be meeting live in person. So if you live in the DFW area and you'd like to come either be interviewed or watch a practice interview, you're welcome to come do that. It's at right here at Christ United Methodist Church, 3101 Coit Road in Plano. It's the southwest corner of Parker and Coit. Next Thursday, being the first Thursday of the month, we're going to talk all about effective resumes, primarily how resumes are formatted for an ATS system. So come join us for that presentation. This session has been recorded. It will be on the Career DFW Facebook page and the Career USA YouTube channel. On the Career USA YouTube channel, click on playlist and then select whichever playlist you want. Every video I put up goes into a playlist. As of yesterday, I think I posted the 590th presentation. So this will be 591 today. Just circle down where you see that red circle. You don't want to click on the video, but click down below that red circle says view full playlist. And when you do that, up will come a list in chronological order of all the presentations, and you can go back and watch whichever one you like. Please note that if you're watching AM from the North Dallas Plano Career Focus Group, our speakers start about 30 minutes into the presentation. Come join us today for lunch. We're going to go to Dickie's Barbecue, just north of Parker, south of Spring Creek on Preston Road. We'll be there at 11:45. For everybody here in the room, we're going to do a little open forum, and we'll see whatever else we can answer for you. So thank you very much for joining us, everybody online. We'll see you hopefully next week.
Thank you.